Hello everyone and welcome back. I'd like to introduce you to our next speaker, Dr. Elizabeth or Zibi Turtle from Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory. Her research contains remote sensing observations and modeling of geological structures and their implications for planetary surfaces, interiors, and their evolution, including impact cratering and tectonics on satellites and terrestrial planets. She is the principal investigator for the Dragonfly New Frontiers mission to Titan. And she's also the principal investigator for the Europa Imaging System, or EIS, on the Europa Clipper, and has participated in the Galileo, Cassini, and Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter missions. She has earned her Ph.D. in the Planetary Sciences from the University of Arizona, and her B.S. in Physics from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Thank you, and please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here virtually today to talk about our Dragonfly New Frontiers mission to Titan. And I always like to start by recognizing that missions like this, of course, are the work of very many people. There are hundreds of people working on Dragonfly at this point. And this is a picture from our hybrid team meeting just last year. So the work that I'll be presenting today, of course, is the result of the effort of a very large team of people. So why do we want to go to Saturn's moon Titan? We don't know how life came to form on Earth, and it's very difficult to study our prebiotic history because biology is overprinted, all of that. So we look to other places in our solar system that can provide clues to the processes that ultimately led to life here on Earth. And in many ways, especially chemically, Titan is most like the early Earth. And so it holds important keys to understanding our chemical origins. Titan is the largest of Saturn's 62 moons. It stands out here in this picture, this combined picture of Titan with its siblings in the Saturnian system, not only because it's bigger than the other Saturnian moons, but also because Titan has an atmosphere. And this is very unusual. It's the only satellite in the solar system that has a dense atmosphere. And this is actually pretty unusual for planets as well. So Titan is between Mercury and Mars in size, and its atmosphere is actually denser than Earth's atmosphere. So the surface pressure at Titan's surface is 1.5 times that of the atmospheric surface pressure here on Earth. A few other facts about Titan. It's the second largest moon in the solar system behind Jupiter's Ganymede. The surface gravity is 1/7 that of the gravity here on Earth. But the surface temperature out at Saturn's orbit, the surface temperature of Titan is 94 Kelvin. So at this temperature, the bedrock of Titan is water ice. And the atmospheric composition, while mostly nitrogen like our atmosphere, the next major constituent is methane. And that's where things get particularly interesting. As I mentioned, the surface pressure is about 1.5 times the atmospheric surface pressure here on Earth. And deep beneath the water ice crust of Titan is an interior ocean of liquid water. So Titan, like many of the moons in the outer solar system, is an ocean world. So I mentioned the methane makes things very interesting. At the top of Titan's atmosphere, the methane breaks down and the molecules recombine to form very complex organic molecules. And this material falls out of the atmosphere onto the surface. It's what gives Titan its hazy appearance when you look at it from space. The aerosols in the atmosphere eventually fall out onto the surface. And now we've got the opportunity for those organic molecules to mix with liquid water at places where the surface crust has melted. And so this is what makes Titan such an important destination for understanding the kinds of chemical processes that might have occurred on Earth in the past. A few other facts about Titan. So out at the orbit of Saturn, the year is 29.5 Earth years. The axial tilt of the system is a little more than the axial tilt of the Earth-Moon system. So Titan has seasons the same way Earth does. In northern winter, the North Pole isn't illuminated, and the South Pole is illuminated all of the time. Except that for Titan, the seasons are several years long as opposed to a few months. So the timescales are much more extended. Titan's day also is very extended. Titan is tidally locked to Saturn, and its day is 16 Earth days long. So the timescales are extended, and this actually results in the atmosphere being fairly sluggish. The variation in surface temperature from day to night, from pole to pole, from summer to winter, is about a Kelvin. So there really isn't a lot of variability in the surface temperature to drive really dynamic activity in the atmosphere. There is some activity, and we'll talk about that, but it's really a pretty sluggish atmosphere, which makes it quite benign for exploration. So to speak about the exploration of the Saturnian system briefly, the Pioneer 11, Voyager 1, and Voyager 2 spacecraft flew by the late 70s, early 80s. This was around the time of the northern vernal equinox in Titan and Saturn's year. The Cassini spacecraft, which was an orbiter that went into orbit around Saturn, arrived almost a Titan year later. It arrived in late northern winter. And Cassini carried with it a probe that was designed to descend through Titan's atmosphere and study Titan's atmosphere. And so when that event occurred in January 2005, again, it was late northern winter at Titan. The Cassini spacecraft continued its mission for 13 years. So from late northern winter all the way through the northern summer solstice. So it experienced almost half of a Titan year, which gave us an incredible data set about Titan and its weather patterns. The Dragonfly mission will arrive at Titan with the timing of NASA's New Frontiers program. It will arrive at Titan about one Titan year later after the Cassini mission arrived. So from the Cassini observations of Titan, we've built up a map of its surface. Before Cassini arrived, we knew very little about the nature of Titan's surface. And now we understand its geology. We have mapped out its geography. And it is a surprisingly Earth-like place for a moon in the outer solar system with very different surface material than we have here on Earth. So you'll see a few features here that are circular. These are impact craters, but like Earth, there are not a lot of impact craters on Titan. This is because the same reason as on Earth, there's a lot of processes in the atmosphere on the surface that modify the surface and therefore erase, erode, and bury impact craters. So Titan has a fairly young surface age, the same way Earth does because of this consistent activity. These dark areas around Titan's equator that are shown in brown in this color-enhanced infrared map of Titan's surface are actually sand dunes. But they're not sand dunes like we're familiar with. They're not silicate sand. They're organic sand. The sand particles are about the same size as the sand particles here on Earth, but their composition is very different. So these are two synthetic aperture radar images from the Cassini spacecraft. So what you're seeing here, the features that show up as bright are rough at the wavelength of the Cassini radar, which was 2.2 centimeters, so about an inch. And then the areas that are dark are very smooth. And what you see here is the sand dunes wrapping around various topographic highs, hills on the surface of Titan, rough hills on the surface of Titan. So there are these huge seas of organic sand dunes at Titan's equator. There are also some tectonic structures. There are hills or mountains a kilometer or so high. Again, though, you can see that these are kind of the younger features are the sand dunes that are kind of overprinted on other geologic features on Titan. There are also some hints of cryovolcanism. This would be cold volcanism where on Titan, the lava would be liquid water or possibly a liquid water ammonia mixture. This is one of those features. This is a combined synthetic aperture radar stereo with the near-infrared observations of the surface that give some sense of the materials on the surface. And so what we have here is this deep pit called Sotra Patera, and it's right next to a mountain. So this is very similar to volcanoes we see elsewhere in the solar system. However, there's no definitive proof that this is a cryovolcano, and there was no evidence of any active cryovolcanism, certainly during the Cassini mission. So if this has been a cryovolcano, it has been dormant or extinct for quite a long time. Nonetheless, it's very intriguing. There is cryovolcanism through the solar system, and it's one of the processes that may have acted in Titan's past and could bring liquid water to the surface where it would have had the opportunity to mix with the organic rich material. So another thing that methane does in Titan's atmosphere is it actually plays the role that water does here on Earth. So what you're seeing here are methane clouds. This is a near infrared, these are both near infrared images. On the right is a movie. Looking down on Titan's North Pole near Titan's summer solstice, northern summer solstice. So you're seeing features on the at the North Pole that I'll talk about a little more in a bit. And these very bright features are methane clouds in Titan's atmosphere. And there's actually, Cassini actually observed evidence of methane rain a couple of times during the mission. And there are channels on the surface, very distributed all over the surface of Titan. And then at the North Pole, we have these three very large seas of liquid methane and ethane. And then we also have a lot of little lakes around the North Pole. To give you a sense of scale, the sea here, Ligia Mare, is about 500 kilometers across. So these are very extensive seas of liquid methane and ethane, 100 or 200 meters deep. So Titan is kind of a world of two oceans, right? We have the liquid water ocean in the interior, and then we have these seas of liquid methane at Titan's North Pole. The Huygens probe I mentioned was designed to descend down through Titan's atmosphere, make measurements of the atmosphere, and it had the capability to return data from the surface. It did indeed survive landing on the surface and returned this spectacular view looking out over a gravel plain, again, a very familiar kind of landscape on Titan, a gravel plain with these kind of rounded cobbles. The image on the right here is, of course, an image of our moon, and it shows you the scale. So it gives you a sense of the scale of the rocks you're seeing here. And these would be water ice rocks on Titan's surface. So we know that Titan has the key ingredients necessary for life, certainly life as we know it. There is energy in the form of sunlight that drives this very rich photochemistry in Titan's atmosphere. There's the organic material that is produced by those processes that falls out onto the surface, and then there is liquid in the system. There's liquid water, which has been available at the surface in Titan's past at potentially sites of cryovolcanism, certainly at sites of impact cratering, where the energy deposited from the impact will melt the crust and will result in a warm pool of liquid water that persists for quite an extended period of time. And then, of course, there's the liquid water ocean deep in Titan's interior. But there's also another liquid in the system, which is the methane in Titan's active methane cycle, and the possibility that methane could support the development of an exotic biological system. So not only do we have this chemistry on Titan that's very much like the chemistry that might have existed here on the early Earth, On Titan, we can study this chemistry in the context of a planetary environment with very Earth-like surface processes, the same kinds of processes that would be transporting, moving, mixing, modifying materials on Titan's surface would be very much like, or are very much like those that occurred in the past here on early Earth and of course still do. So Titan offers us the next step to answer fundamental questions. What makes a planet, or in this case, a moon, habitable? What are the chemical processes that led to the development of life? And even, has life developed elsewhere in our solar system? Now, of course, at 94 Kelvin, we don't expect that the environment on the surface of Titan is conducive, certainly to life as we know it. But nonetheless, it's important to ask the question, and we have the capability to seek chemical biosignatures if chemistry did actually take the leap to biology in Titan's past. So Cassini showed us where we need to go on Titan's surface to look for answers to these questions. There's a diverse array of surface materials and environments. There's this wide and Earth-like variety of geologic processes. So the challenge became, how do we get instruments to multiple sites to be able to sample materials and measure the composition of the surface? But Titan's environment gives us a mechanism to do that, because heavier than air flight is much more efficient at Titan. In fact, it's easier to fly on Titan than it is here on Earth. That's because the atmospheric density is 4 times higher than the density here, which reduces the area of wings or rotors required to generate a certain amount of lift. And the lower gravity reduces the amount of power required. So even a person could put on, don wings and soar over the surface of Titan, which would be an absolutely fascinating way to explore, although you'd need a good way to keep warm in the cold temperatures there. So this is why Dragonfly is designed as a rotorcraft, to be able to take advantage of Titan's atmosphere and fly from place to place. Like the rovers on Mars, it's very useful scientifically to be able to study a variety of places and to go from place to place to be able to make measurements. Unlike Mars, we do not have a fleet of orbiters at Titan to relay data. So Dragonfly has its own high gain antenna. It will transmit data from the surface of Titan directly to Earth. But like the rovers on Mars, we'll carry everything with us from place to place as we explore Titan. So just briefly, here's some of these are the mission elements that make up Dragonfly. There's a crew stage. This is the element that will take Dragonfly from Earth through its interplanetary trajectory out to Titan. There's also an entry vehicle. This is the vehicle that encapsulates Dragonfly itself, the lander itself, and protects it as we descend down through the atmosphere, protects it from that atmospheric entry. And then, of course, there's the lander itself. And as I said, we carry our entire payload from place to place. We make measurements on the surface, but can also make measurements in flight, including aerial imaging and atmospheric and profiles of atmospheric characteristics. We do direct to Earth communication, as I mentioned, from the surface of Titan. And Dragonfly is designed to be powered by an MMRTG. This is a multi-mission radioisotope thermoelectric generator. It's the same power source that powers the Curiosity and Perseverance rovers on Mars. For Dragonfly, we use this to charge a battery, which gives us the high power needed to fly over the Titan surface. The MMRTG actually has a fair amount of excess heat or waste heat, but this is actually perfect for Dragonfly because we can use that heat to keep the interior of the lander warm. And so the interior is at a good temperature for all of the instruments and the components, the electrical components of the lander. And then we have a very insulated exterior to keep all of that heat inside. Because we're used to thinking about rotorcraft sometimes as small vehicles, Dragonfly is not a small vehicle. Dragonfly is about the size of the Curiosity or Perseverance rovers on Mars. And so for just to give a sense of scale, this is me, and I know you don't know how tall I am, but I'm pretty average in height. And so this is me holding one of the prototype rotors, just to give a sense of scale of the vehicle itself. So Dragonfly is scheduled to launch in June of 2027, and the interplanetary trajectory gets us to Titan by 2034. We do direct atmospheric entry. We don't need to go into orbit or around Saturn or Titan. We go straight into the atmosphere. But Titan's atmosphere is very extended because it's a very large, dense atmosphere, and Titan has very low gravity. So this process is very different, again, from the entry we're used to observing on Mars, right? The 7 minutes from the top of Mars' atmosphere to the surface. On Titan, that takes 2 hours. It's a much longer descent. There's much more time for all of those different activities to take place. As you saw in the video at the bottom of the descent, Dragonfly releases from the back shell and actually flies to its first landing site under its own power. And that initial landing site is near Titan's equator in these organic dunes and interdunes. This is a very good place to land for a couple of reasons. One is that the dunes and interdunes have different compositions on Titan. So I mentioned the dunes have this organic sand, or composed of this organic sand. The interdunes on Titan actually have water ice. And I should specify, this is not Titan, this is the Namib Desert on Earth. But this is a very good analog to the type of dunes we have on Titan. And so you see here the dunes and interdune areas. It's a very similar geology on Titan, but with the different materials. The other benefit of landing in this area is that these inner dunes are wide and flat, so they are perfect landing sites. So we initially start our exploration of Titan in the dune inner dune area. This allows us to measure different materials on Titan, materials with very different geologic histories. And then over the course of the mission, we move north to explore the deposits associated with this impact crater called Selk. Selk is about an 80 kilometer diameter impact crater. And so it's a place where, when the impact occurred, there may have been an opportunity for liquid water to mix with these very complex organic molecules for possibly for very extended periods of time. So this is a very important destination to be able to understand the kinds of chemistry that can occur when you put all of these ingredients together for a long period of time. So Dragonfly's mission is a little over 3 years, and during this time we'll traverse the dunes and interdunes and then into deposits associated with the impact crater itself, traversing over 100 kilometers, exploring a couple dozen unique sites. And I should mention that the topography here is exceedingly exaggerated. Titan is actually pretty subdued topography, like most icy satellites. The dunes themselves are 50 to 100 meters high. And of course, this traverse here, or that what's shown here, is about 200 kilometers long. So it's actually quite low topography. Another difference between exploring Titan and exploring Mars, we don't have a lot of spacecraft to scout for us, to take very high resolution data for Dragonfly the way the Mars rovers have the high-rise instrument on the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter to make very high-resolution observations to scout areas to explore. So for Dragonfly, we need to do our own scouting. And to do this, we have a leapfrog strategy, where when we take off from one site to land at the next scouted site, we actually would fly past that site to another potential landing site to scout that, and then come back to the previously scouted landing site. And this way we can look ahead to potential landing sites to evaluate them for hazards, for safety of the landing site, but also scientifically. Is this the kind of terrain we want to explore? Is this an area with new geology that we haven't explored before, new compositional new compositions of materials, things like that. So this allows us to do that scouting, and then we come back, send the data back to Earth, and have, I'm sure, very dynamic discussions will ensue about where the best place to land in the potential landing zone will be. With Titan's 16-day Titan sols, our nominal flight schedule is actually only about once every other Titan day. So this is actually a flight once per Earth month, which means most of the time is spent on the surface making science measurements, downlinking data to Earth, and performing these ground-in-the-loop operations. So we actually can have a fairly relaxed kind of time scale. Nobody has to live on Titan time the way people often live on Mars time during the early days of Mars missions. We can schedule things more easily given the length of the Titan day. So Dragonfly is fundamentally a chemistry mission. The focus is understanding Titan's prebiotic chemistry. What are the chemical components available? What processes are at work, and are they producing biologically relevant compounds? But we want to be able to put that into the context of the Titan environment. We want to understand the methane cycle. We want to understand the organic cycle, the processes that are transporting, mixing, modifying these organic materials on the surface, and the processes that allow them to mix with liquid water, liquid reservoirs, liquid water in the past or in the present day ocean in particular. And then we also have the capability to search for chemical biosignatures if biology did develop. But fundamentally, what we want to understand is the chemistry that occurs before that leap to biology. So we have a suite of instruments, and I'll talk through each of these in a little more detail. But we have a mass spectrometer that is fed by a sampling system. And then we have a gamma ray and neutron spectrometer that is shown in purple here. We have a suite of geophysics and meteorology sensors that are kind of distributed. They're shown in yellow here, kind of distributed around the lander. And then we have a suite of cameras as well. So this is the DRACO system, the sampling system. We break up the surface material, and we can use pneumatic transfer to bring it into the mass spectrometer, just like a vacuum cleaner, because we have this great atmosphere on Titan. The mass spectrometer has two modes. There's a laser desorption mode that allows us to measure aspects of the chemical composition of materials that are sampled and brought into the mass spectrometer. And then there's also a gas chromatography mode. And this mode allows us to measure aspects of the structure of the molecules. One of those aspects in particular is the chirality, is for molecules that have mirrored structures, this can be a key biosignature, a key chemical biosignature, because abiotic processes tend to produce equal amounts of both, but biological processes tend to prefer one over the other. And so measuring the amount of those molecules with different handedness can indicate whether there's abiotic or biological process responsible for producing that molecule. The gamma ray neutron spectrometer allows us to classify the surface materials at each of our landing sites by measuring the bulk elemental surface composition. And so we can detect minor inorganic elements, and we can even reveal near surface stratigraphy. If, for example, there is a layer of organic material over a layer of water ice a few centimeters or tens of centimeters down, we'll be able to detect that that subsurface layer of water ice. The meteorological and geophysical monitoring allows us to understand the Titan environment that we're in. So we can monitor atmospheric conditions, temperature, pressure, methane, humidity, wind speed, et cetera. We can also do atmospheric profiles by making measurements as we fly up to different altitudes. And then on the geophysics side, we can measure aspects of the regolith that we're landed on. And in fact, search or listen for Titan quakes. We have geophones and a seismometer, And this allows us to determine the level of seismic activity on an ocean world, which has a very different seismic environment than we're used to here on the terrestrial planets because of that interior liquid water ocean. So that's going to be a fascinating experiment. And then we have, as I mentioned, a suite of cameras. So you can see some of the windows the cameras look out of because the cameras want to be, the cameras themselves need to be kept a little warmer. But of course, we have to have windows for them to look through the exterior of the lander. So you can see that kind of in this this graphic from below the lander. We'll be able to image around the lander. Ahead of the lander, of course. We also have these downward pointing cameras that will show us what the site, the surface looks like right under the lander. And then we have microscopic imagers as well. And these allow us to get very high resolution observations of the material before we sample it. And then we can also look at that area after we've sampled it as well. And these areas, we have suites or arrays of LEDs of different wavelengths. And by illuminating the surface with these different wavelengths, we'll be able to look for different compositions in the surface materials that we sample with the drill. We also have one of those LEDs is ultraviolet wavelengths because a lot of organic molecules fluoresce when illuminated by ultraviolet light. So at night, we'll be able to take images of the surface under UV illumination and look for different types of organics. So that'll be a pretty neat and probably kind of spooky observation. So there's a lot of work that's been going on over the past few years as we've moved through our preliminary design phase. One of the major activities, of course, has been developing the navigation for Dragonfly. And so we've done a lot of testing of our test bed in desert areas that have similar geography to the terrain we'll be flying over on Titan to test our optical navigation, our terrain relative navigation algorithms. And so this video, which is hopefully playing through clearly on through the Zoom, shows the testing we've done, which has now led us through entirely autonomous flights from takeoff through the navigation in the air to landing of our testbed of the system. So that's been excellent progress and something that's been a lot of fun to watch as well as we've demonstrated the different guidance and control algorithms. Another thing that we've been doing on Dragonfly, of course, with the exploration of the outer solar system, we have very long timeframes, right? Launching in 2027, arrival in the mid 2030s. So this gives us the opportunity and the responsibility to reach out expand participation in missions across generations, scientific generations. And so we have a student guest investigator program that has had two cohorts so far. We're just selecting our third cohort. And this lists the different projects the students are working on. This is a program designed to expand participation to students who don't already have connections or experience with planetary science or space exploration, and has been a really great program that NASA funded for the Dragonfly mission to be able to really look into ways to extend opportunities for new people to join planetary missions. So we'll be advertising for a fourth cohort early next year. As I said, our third cohort is just coming on board. So this is another area of work that we're pursuing in parallel with all of the development work for the Dragonfly mission. So I will close here, but I'm happy to take some questions if we have time for that.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Zibi. It was an interesting and fascinating talk. We do have a slew of questions, so please bear with us. We'll start off with a question that asks, what energy source is keeping Titan's oceans liquid?
So the liquid water ocean in Titan's interior will primarily be energy from the origin of Titan. The materials, there's radioactive decay of materials that every planet, is formed of, and that decay keeps things warm early on in the history, as well as the energy from the, all of the material that kind of impacts and coagulates to form a planet, right? There's a lot of energy deposited in that early accumulation of material into a planet. So those are the two really early sources of heat for a planet. Longer term, often in these large satellite systems, you can have tidal heating as well. If you get resonances between satellites, the Jovian system is a beautiful example of that, with the satellites Io, Europa, and Ganymede all in a resonance that provides enough heat that Io has silicate volcanism on it. So that's another way you can get heating in the interior, but a lot of this is still just kind of the primordial heating and the satellites not having completely cooled off.
Awesome. Our next question asks how Dragonfly orients itself. Is it because of the sun or some other factors?
How Dragonfly
orients itself.
Orients?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll have sensors and we'll be able to determine our position by tracking Dragonfly from Earth. And then all of the navigation on Titan is terrain relative navigation. We don't need to do really pinpoint precise navigation. We just need to be able to track northward toward the crater. And so we'll be able to locate Dragonfly with tracking from Earth. And then we will command Dragonfly to fly northward. Dragonfly has to, let me step back a second. Dragonfly has to be able to do everything autonomously. The round trip light time to Titan is very long. And so Dragonfly, all of these flights will actually be shorter than the actual light time. So all of that has to happen autonomously. So that's why we're testing these autonomous navigation algorithms for the terrain relative navigation. But what we will do is tell Dragonfly to fly, to fly northward for, some distance to get past the next dune or two to do the scouting. And Dragonfly, as it flies, will keep track of where it has identified safe landing sites all the way along the ground track, and always know where the nearest safe landing site is. So all of that navigation is done via optical navigation.
Awesome. Since you touched on the subject of autonomous travel with Dragonfly, we have a follow-up question asking how much input from Earth will Dragonfly need to navigate to a destination?
So Dragonfly will be commanded to navigate to a certain distance, and then the actual navigation is performed by Dragonfly, and the hazard avoidance is performed by Dragonfly. But everything is commanded from the Earth.
Awesome. Does Titan's denser atmosphere makes it easier or harder to land compared to like Earth or even Mars?
It makes it easier to fly. It doesn't make it any harder to land. It's easier in the fact that there is less power required for the lift, and so then it's also easier to land gently.
Our next question asks whether the heat loading on the heat shield is the same, better, or worse than the Mars EDL.
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know the peak heating off the top of my head. Sorry, I don't remember the peak heating off the top of my head. It is more extended in time. So that makes it more challenging, because there's enough time that it is being heated during that initial entry to the atmosphere that heat pulse can kind of propagate through the heat shield. So we need to be very aware of the, you know, we need to do a lot of modeling to understand what the temperature of the interior will be. I don't remember the actual peak heating, but the duration is definitely more challenging because of the longer time in the atmosphere.
Awesome, thank you. Our next question asks that the water, ice, sand makes sense, but what exactly are the organic sands? What, you know, are they made of?
We don't know. we really don't. The fact that there were sand dunes on Titan was somewhat of a surprise, and the fact that the sand has an organic composition is not understood. As you say, right, it's much easier to explain, it would be much easier to explain water, ice, sand, right? That's how sand forms on Earth. It forms by breakdown of the bedrock, erosion of the bedrock into fine particles. So if the bedrock water ice on Titan were being eroded into fine particles and creating water ice sand, that would be a lot easier to explain. What we don't know is whether the sand particles are actually water ice cored with an organic kind of coating, or if somehow the aerosols, the particulates that are falling out of the atmosphere, if there's a process that can actually, you know, agglomerate those into sand-sized particles. So the short answer is we don't know. We hope to be able to find out, but it is something that we don't understand about Titan at this point, how the sand is generated.
Absolutely. So building on that question, are there any planned missions in the future to retrieve the organic chemicals or any other biologically relevant compounds?
So Dragonfly will sample them and measure their composition. Dragonfly stays on Titan, but it will be able to, you know, to sample the organics and tell us what they are made of. There are no plans at this point for a mission that would go to Titan and bring something back. To some extent, it's actually much easier to go there and do the measurements in situ in the environment than try to preserve the nature of these very cold, organics through a long interplanetary trajectory back to Earth.
Absolutely. So a bit more like a question regarding like the imaging systems. So what are some challenges of running it on Titan? Or do you use like regular glass lenses or some other ones?
Yeah, so we'll have windows in the body of the lander, and those will allow us to keep the cameras warmer. And so we'll heat the cameras up before they do any imaging. But these are the same cameras. These cameras have the same design as the cameras used on the Mars rovers. So the only challenge is keeping everything warm. Although Titan is, you know, much further than from the sun than Earth, and there's this hazy atmosphere, the illumination on the surface of Titan is kind of like the illumination in a conference room, the illumination of the full moon. So it's actually fairly bright on the surface. One of the things we need to pay a lot of attention to is how long the exposure times are, and for the cameras, especially when we want to be able to image during flight. Fortunately, there's enough light, enough illumination that is something that we will be able to do with the same camera design.
So someone in the audience has a more, I guess, personal or job-related question. As the imaging system PI, what do you do? What are you responsible for? And how many imaging systems are under your wings?
So the Europa Imaging System, for which I'm the PI, is the camera suite for NASA's Europa Clipper mission. And that suite has two cameras. There's a narrow angle camera and a wide angle camera. And this allows us, because the Europa spacecraft does very fast flybys of Europa, having the two cameras allows us to get context imaging and stereo imaging, and then also very high resolution imaging at the scale of a meter per pixel or even better. So there are those two cameras that I am responsible for as the PI for the Europa Imaging System. One of them has been delivered and has been integrated with the spacecraft just this past summer, and the other is undergoing its final testing here at APL before delivery in a few months.
Mm-hmm. Is there a mechanism for recovering from turtling? A pun, I don't know if it was intended, but it was basically landing on its back for Dragonfly?
Is the question if there's
a mechanism for recovering from landing, for Dragonfly landing on its back?
No. Dragonfly is designed to stay upright. There would not be a mechanism for recovery. And in fact, we do a lot of analysis of the kind of landing dynamics to make sure that Dragonfly's center of gravity keeps it stable, so we would not tip over during landing or something like that.
Okay, we only have just a few questions left. So, is there a concern about rotor wash disrupting the surface sampling sites?
Yeah, there. So we do have to consider that that there may be material kicked up from the surface as we land. A lot of the imaging and sensors take data at slightly higher altitude before the rotor wash would be able to start kicking material up, so that we have all the data, so that Dragonfly has all the data it needs to be able to land safely, even if there is obscuration. That's absolutely something we need to pay attention to. On the converse side, one of the neat things we can do with Dragonfly's rotors is interact with the environment to understand what the saltation threshold is for the sands, how fast the wind needs to blow for the sands to be transported. And so we can actually do a sequence of observations where we take images and speed the rotors up to see how fast the wind needs to be generated from the rotor to get the sand to move. So there's a kind of a converse silver lining to that potential to be able to make science measurements of the nature of the particulate motions on the surface.
Right. So on the subject of flying, are there any issues that have arisen or been known of so far for 3 years of flying?
So we don't fly all the time. We spend most of the time on the surface. We fly for about half an hour each time, so it's only about half an hour each month that we'd be flying. But we do need to make sure that the motors and the rotors are designed for that, for activity over that duration of a mission, and that the heaters, the heating cycles that we're able to, the heaters are able to heat up the motors consistently over the duration of the mission. So that's part of our test plan, of course, for all the different components, is to make sure that they can function over the duration of the mission and for the number of cycles that they would experience throughout the duration of the mission.
Okay, one final question. How does one get a job working on Dragonfly?
There are a lot of different jobs working on Dragonfly. Planetary missions, you need like every skill set to work on planetary missions, right? I mean, we always think about the scientists and the engineers, but we need a lot of people that are doing communication and graphics, as you can see in the graphics I've showed today. There are a lot of different skill sets needed on missions, and there are a lot of different institutions that are partnered with Dragonfly. Certainly APL here in Maryland is one of the places where there are a lot of jobs on Dragonfly, and I know you can go to the APL website and apply for positions that way. There are a number of universities and other NASA centers, and a lot of those have internships as well as permanent jobs related to Dragonfly. So there's some information about that on our website. You can also go to the APL website or the Goddard Space Flight Center or the Ames Space Flight Center, Ames Research Center websites and look for internship and job opportunities that way. If you'd be interested in working with Dragonfly.
Awesome. Thank you very much. So that's all the time we have for questions today. If you're fine with it, we can send you the remaining questions through email, and then you can answer them at your leisure. But once again, we want to thank you very much, Zibi, for attending our Aerospace Expo. And it was a great talk. Thank you again.
Thank you. It's a pleasure talking with you.